directions. I wrote in a paper.
Mein Kampf? I should expel you.
Go ahead. Well, you don't think I could handle it?
No, I think the street would kill you. Your rhetoric and your propaganda aren't going to save you out there. So here's the drill. I'm your history teacher from now on. We will discuss current events. We will call this class American History X.
It's everywhere I look now.
What?
This affirmative action.
The white man marches on!
See this? That means not welcome.
I trust you, Derek.
Drop your weapon!
All there is a
all that anger
deeper ever
all that hate
flowing.
Has anything you've done made your life better?
The hurt and pain.
Derek Vineyard was released from Chino early this morning.
Hey man, how you doing?
Too big to give me a hug?
Oh, it's good to see you. Check this out, man.
Where'd you get that?
What?
Well, I came to talk about Danny. He's headed right where you are.
What's wrong with you?
Let the kid alone. The big joint mess is mine.
Good.
I'm asking you to do whatever's in your power.
You know what you can do? You can get me shot by a bunch of white boys.
I am out, and Danny is out too. And if you come near my family again,
I will feed you your heart.
Robin! What's happening, Seth?
I don't think you realize what's been going on here. We are 10 times what we were.
Yeah. They're gonna come for me. There's nothing I can do. Hey, Danny! Get it! This is Pedro Serrano, and welcome to yet another thrilling installment of The Life We Lead. Wahoo! And anyway, we're getting ready to go out for a night at the cinema.
Sailor!
Hey, baby! How you doing? And so we're just hanging out, and we're going to go see a movie called American History X. It's opening night, so we're first nighters. We're going to go out and check out the movie, and we'll be back a little later on with a review of the show, of the movie. And we'll let you know from the skinhead perspective what this movie, you know, what we think about the movie. We're going to do a Siskel and Ebert. We're going to give it a thumbs up or a thumbs down or, you know, something like that. Yeah, so we'll see you later. Enjoy this thrilling music, yeah. We'll be back after this. Yeah, that's what they look like.
Woke up, hung, knocked on the bricks. Don't know where the hell I am. Who's thinking next to me? What did I do? I gotta be. Can't work or go to school today. Can't remember if I do that anyway. That's money, got the food, the world's a mess. I am alone, I am alone, I am alone, I am alone. Grass a car, lost a job, I'm dirty, spending total slop. Lots of sex, little love, stimulation, no sanity.
theater. It was sold out, but Skinhead Determination won out. We got in. And it was all, there were like another like 20 skinheads in there watching the movie with us. American History X, which we're going to review a little later. You're going to see a video by the Skoydats, and you're going to see him portray a drunken skinhead. Your performance is amazing, I understand.
Yeah, I'm a good actor, aren't I?
Yeah. People might actually believe that you were drunk in this video.
Tell
us about the filming. What was that all like?
The filming was very cool. We met up with the Skoydats there, and when we got in, they announced it was free beer all day.
So, 8 hours.
8 hours of free beer, and then we had a lunch break, and then we got to drink more beer.
Mm-hmm.
And it got to the point where you'll see where I was trying to stack up the shot glasses because we were drinking shots. And I had them almost in a perfect triangle until I fell on them on the bar, and I broke some glasses.
Aww. Okay, I understand the director was really impressed by, or maybe not impressed. How did he feel about it?
He was mad because we kept trashing his place. So he said, he directed a Public Enemy video or one of those rap bands, and he said, Wu-Tang, that's what it was,
Wu-Tang.
And he said he's never seen nothing like this before. He said, get these guys out of here, they're too drunk and they're too wild and crazy. So we had to stop filming, but yeah. The video came out really cool, as you will
see. Of course, authenticity is what counts. So you check this out. This is the Skoydats with Last Night. And I'll be back after this. Let's get out of here. It's cold out here.
Oh, yeah.
It's a story of a family and a man within his family, much more than it is a film about skinheads. It's not really an exploration of the world or milieu of skinhead culture or music or anything. That's very much the backdrop or the specific sort of stimulus within the story of this family, and especially within the story of these two brothers and how one witnesses the other go through this journey, and you know, the tension of this story is much more about what is the fate of this family going to be, and what is the tragic cost that this family incurs, than it is about any kind of specific social setting.
Drop your weapon! Put your weapon on the ground! Put your hands up! I said get your hands up! Now turn around! Put your hands behind your head! Get down on your knees right now!
It shows the promise of hope. It shows that people can change. It shows, to some degree, the means by which we might be able to change. Certainly, how we might begin to stop, passing our prejudices along to our children. I mean, I've always liked Eddie Furlong and Terminator 2. I think that both Terminator movies are among my favorite movies ever. I love them. And I loved him in Terminator 2. And he's been excellent in other pieces, you know, the Before and After and Little Odessa. And I wanted him for the piece, and he came in and interviewed, and he came back and read, and his reading was stunning, and so we cast him, and we expected him to be really good. He's way beyond what we expected. There's something about this kid. I think it's going to be a great, great breakthrough performance for Eddie Furlong.
It's hard to tell if a movie's going to be good, and I just read the script, and I'm just like, you know, this movie is going to be an intense film, and I thought that just the depth of the script was, you know, probably what pulled me into it the most.
Oh, come on, give the guy a break.
What's the matter, you too big to give me a hug, tough guy?
No, man, I just know you're gonna, you know, need someone to look after you while you adjust all this space.
Yeah, right. This place is smaller than the old living room. How you doing? How's school?
It's good. Yeah? It's good. You gotta do something about that hair, man. That dude's gotta go.
Yeah, I don't know. The girls like it, so.
Well, I don't.
You're keeping it pretty close. You took it all the way down, huh?
Yeah. Look, I forgot, man. It hurt like while you were putting it on, man.
When did you get that?
I got it about a month ago. Cameron made it official.
Cameron?
Yeah.
He put this on you?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Hello.
What?
Hi. Yes, yes. Derek, it's for you.
Nothing.
All right, we're back from that huge... American History X. And that gigantic theater complex type thing is huge. I couldn't believe the size of that thing. I was never there before. And so we saw the movie, so we're just going to like do a round table kind of thing. I'm just going to have... This is Junior, Salvador.
No last name.
He's like... No last name. He's like Cher.
That's right.
Or Madonna.
Yeah.
Is this Junior?
That's right.
And he sings for Heidnik Stu. So you saw American History X.
What do I have to do first? Oh, yes, I saw that movie. And I believe that the turning point in the movie was the dichotomy of the...
No. What do you want to say? I don't know, like, right, you saw the movie. Like, what, like...
Very well made documentary.
It wasn't a documentary.
Oh, yeah.
No, it was a good movie.
I thought it was a documentary on me.
It was a good movie
with
an after-school special feel to it.
That was exactly what I was thinking. Especially like after the prison story type thing. It turned into a total, in my opinion, it had an after school. It started turning into an after school special.
It was like a moral.
A cautionary tale. Yeah, go ahead.
It had morals.
Be careful on that quote.
What?
Siskel Ebert said that.
Said what?
It was a really, really long after-school
special. Okay, wow. See, okay, so there you
go. Well, this ain't going on, like, cable TV, so right. I don't know.
Hold on a second, yeah. All right, well, guys, let's do this one at a time, but I did not see the Siskel and Ebert thing.
I know, you didn't know that.
I didn't know that, but Siskel and Ebert type feel. Wow, gee, great minds think
alike. Thumbs up.
Hey, a thumbs up for him. What about you?
I got a half.
Introduce your name. Who are you?
I'm Nate. This is kind of a upward thumb. I didn't like the tug-of-war aspect of the fence there in the middle, the guy walking on it, being tugged on each side. I didn't like it.
Now, what do you mean you didn't like it?
Well, you know, he's got his thing going, you know, he's all white power and all this, and then he goes to jail, he learns that, you know, maybe it's not the way he should be, goes, gets out, thinks he's gonna do the right thing, and then they keep pulling him and pulling him to keep doing the right thing, and it's just, it pissed me off.
Like how there was that scene when they go into that
the cafe
dining room.
Really pissed me off.
That was
upsetting.
Okay.
He didn't do enough just by turning his life around. Now he has to help everybody else.
Right. I see what you mean. Okay. We'll get to that later. How about you?
Oh, Pete next.
Pete. I learned a valuable lesson out of the film that. In jail, underwear only come in mediums and large. I can't fit into them.
You're in trouble. You're going to leave them ignorantly wearing them.
Well, you can't go to jail.
It was a good movie for Hollywood, I would say, but it was still a distorted aspect on what goes on in the outside world. Like, they're seeing one out on people, a group of people, and it's not necessarily true, but for what they try to get across, I give it a thumbs up.
You said it was a good movie for Hollywood, like as compared to a movie like Romper Stomper that also dealt with kind of the same like issues as far as like white power, skinheads. I mean, those are two movies that kind of dealt with the same issue, but I think Romper Stomper was just the best.
Do you notice how American History X starts off, how Romper Stomper ended? Exactly. I think there was a crash there, the waves, it was wrong. Yeah. It was like
Romper Stomper stateside.
Well, because if you think about it, Romper Stomper was a big budget movie made in Australia.
Yeah.
Similar thing there. And I'm telling you, the way Romper Stomper ended and the way this movie began, there's something there. There's no reason why you're doing a
close-up. Our special guest has arrived.
What's the secret word? Stan!
Okay, you were
pretty much done.
But you said it was a good movie for Hollywood.
Yeah, Hollywood always has this glam aspect of everything, and they actually just want to present something to what the people want to see, true or false, and hate, especially race hate, is what people wanted to go see.
We have more guests.
So you weren't expecting to see like a skinhead movies about like general skinheads.
Oh yeah, you knew what you were gonna go see, and that's exactly what they showed you.
Good point. Okay, he's done.
Best turn.
No.
George is like making the perfect
pose. George's
turn.
Didn't go yet.
Where did he go yet?
No. Tomorrow.
Are you George?
Yeah.
George, do you want to make a comment on the film?
Not right now.
Okay. Tim, Sam, you want to talk about the movie? Now they're hiding, cowering away. Sam?
Okay, I'll talk now.
We'll bash you if you don't talk. Okay.
I thought, other than that jail scene, that was like a documentary on my life, Christ. It's proof that white powers can reform. I covered up one of the tattoos. It was an alright movie, I guess.
Alright.
Just alright, like Pete said, it was a Hollywood film.
Hollywood.
And it really didn't depict skinheads the way they really are.
Right.
And the kid from The Terminator didn't belong in that film at all.
That's who that kid was!
too.
Oh man, I was thinking about the whole time. And with the long hair, looked like a little girl. I didn't know who he was
with that baggy clothes.
Yeah, and the voice like that. Now I know why it sounded all familiar.
It's time for us to go. So if you want to write, please, please write. We worry. You don't write enough. So write to our address, which is?
The Life We Lead, P.O. Box 1885, New Brunswick, New Jersey, 08901. Vanna?
I'm not
Sailor.
Sailor.
Hello, boys, and write. Don't forget pictures.
That's it, man. Good night.
Derek, you're too damn smart to be floating around here pretending you don't see all the holes in this boat.
Hey, listen, you know what? I said I was confused. I didn't say I didn't believe in it.
All right, that's why you have to stay open. Right now, your anger is consuming you. Your anger is shutting down the brain God gave you.
God, you know, man, you've been talking about what's going on in me since I was in high school. What do you know about the place I'm in?
There was a moment when I used to blame everything and everyone for all the pain and suffering and vile things that happened to me, that I saw happen to my people. Just blame everybody, blame white people, blame society, blame God. I didn't get no answers because I was asking the wrong questions. You have to ask the right question.
Like what?
Has anything you've done made your life better?
Help me.